welcome to another edition of the Philosophers Book Club.
Tonight, our guest will tackle one of the most influential books since Rogat's Thesaurus and Leonard Maltin's Movie Guide. Our panel will shed some light on John R. Erickson's The Original Adventures of Hank the Cowdog. Before we deconstruct the novel, let's break down the panel.
Nick de Bertemac is an occupant in the vicinity. Is that what you meant by boost your appeal? Stop booing.
Tenzin Gyatso.
Swejin Hengdai.
It does not matter who I am or who you are, as you'll find out soon enough. I came prepared.
I can fix that.
I am Malcolm X.
I am Malcolm X.
I am Malcolm X.
I am Malcolm X.
I take it you all have seen the movie.
Step by step, all the happy saints go marching in.
This is an awfully repressed lot you've gathered here. Do you often dream of being betrayed by your mother whilst perspiring from the heights of a defunct lighthouse?
Every day.
You can't blame me for Hitler, Stalin, or Thatcher. Even though they had admirals.
Hank the Cowdog lends itself to wide interpretation, especially to perceived allegories of social movements. Let's hear what you all think it's about.
There is a plot perpetrated against the sovereign. There occurs murder and confusion that weakens the state. Our characters must first recognize the rebel territories, and then limit external powers in order to fortify the state. Our prince is in quandary. He is without information, and he is neither feared nor loved. Our prince is delusional, but by no means powerless.
Thus interrupted Zarathustra.
The novel provides further insights into a more interesting question. Who truly is in power? One who needs to proclaim himself prince repeatedly surely must not be so. Does true power circle the external lands or perch on soft feet from the roof? Do they navigate the skies or rule from the master quarters? Perhaps from the gunny sacks.
Well, isn't he a motley heifer? Cow of a different color. A banana marauder.
Well, all it's saying is that the establishment are all animals. I mean, there's no way around that. I used to coach tennis once, and, all I can say is it makes no sense to stand on the fence whistling. I'm not a mailman or a waitress, but, with enough sticky notes, I can upend the mercury tarantulas.
I
slaughtered chickens.
Well, here comes the feisty cleaning lady.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that the white man takes pride in his chickens. He teaches us that when his chickens are taken away from him, the white man sends Johnny Dog Law to investigate. Soon as it happens, Johnny Dog Law lets his ignorance guide him, and his ignorance is astounding.
I think he might be sexist or something.
John Dog Law then goes on a witch hunt for the blatant Negro stand-in, the raccoon. White man got to call his coons even in this here fiction. But John Dog Law gets his due diligence with a face full of porcupine quills for his mistaken racist ways.
Malcolm, Hank is colored.
He and Uncle Tom pooch that John Dog Law. Ain't no different than a snow white chihuahua or that pasty cow with mutt. They all cowards.
This
is a highly operatic work of symbol and allegory. The novel single-handedly crushed racial stereotypes and paved the way for the workers' rights movement. Erickson had one of the first texts
to recognize the potential of women. The passage, "He was not a he was a she," meaning a female of species, rather homely, was tremendous. The recurring symbols of ranch, fence, weeds, dog represents the lack of immediacy in the agriculture industry.
Would you care to elaborate?
No.
That's awfully Machiavellian of you.
It's about nothing.
Erickson understand responsibility to dialogue in self-problem. Novel address impulse, quick to punishment, ineffective, tying chicken head to dog, wrong. Blame raccoon for death of chicken, wrong. Trickery toward neighbor, wrong. But punishment sting, novel teach better to embrace, understand differences within environment. No harm. Affection are very much ironically factor.
Why couldn't you get a better poet for this? Why not Allen Ginsberg? What do you got against trees, man?
I don't think he was incubated long enough.
All literature is reincarnation, cycles of interpretation. Reinserting what is relevant into location, plots, and character.
Is that a phallic illusion?
Did he just turn a holy lesson into a sex joke?
I love your work. I am a huge fan of Beatles.
Last time was a disaster, and now they're bringing in folks known for their incendiary rhetoric. And Shasta dropped us. They didn't feel our endorsement strengthen their ties to the philosophical community. I mean, who do they think they are? Pabst? Much discussion of Erickson's novel has been focused on identity. What can you say about the identities found within the story, and which do you most identify with?
Few of these animals seem to function on the level of the superego, which is atypical among fictitious canines. Furthermore, there is a near universal betrayal of the ego, especially in Hank, with his delusions of status. It is likely that Hank not only wanted his mother, but succeeded, developing traumas from each.
No, this is where you, apart from the group, can express your thoughts. Or Elijah Muhammad's.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us.
Have you found meaning? We can shape our existence. Form a connection. Our will is the will to create. Crayola, air dry clay. Build.
The white one. Everybody is moseying about catching blues over power struggles, and that ain't me, man. That dog sleeping 16 hours a day, I must have related to him.
He certainly did.
there is a void of true power at the ranch. Hank is creating power structure and security that only he recognizes, while conforming to it completely. In doing so, he takes great risks. It's fascinating, if not entirely frustrating.
John Dog Law found himself hungry. This hunger drove him from safety, and he found a brotherhood out there, the coyotes, who knew the horrors of the world and were not intimidated. But he betrays them and their freedoms. Uncle Tom Dog Law opts to stay on the white man's farm, where they grow hatred and entitlement with their sauerkraut.
I've seen men battle men on top of men. Man, when the world ends, I don't want to be stuck peeling a potato.
You've been pretty quiet, Frederick. How about some input?
Time to play the game!
Okay, swine, I'll play. Trover is the Ubermint.
Too soon.
He recognizes the futility of Hank's labors. He sleeps. By doing so, he transcends all other pitiful inhabitants of the ranch. He is fearful of waking life because he knows he can only save himself. He avoids, he survives, he even if it means nothing to him. But it is in his will to nothingness that he derives his understanding. There are no anomalies to the vacant.
Jesus, man.
And who was it you most identified with?
Stroke.
Trove.
Trove.
Drover.
Drover.
Turkey buzzard. Ah! Freudian slip.
Okay then, let's get our final verdict.
State has an ineffective leader.
Incompetent host.
Nation?
You better call the police!
Yes! Yes!
Hold on, I thought it was kind of groovy, man.
Depressing. 3, 2.
I'm relieved to have made it. I found Twilight to be a moderate philosophical success, but it contained rousing entertainment. Vampire bats, balls and bats, ball-less bats, battles and brawls, bawling and brats. I enjoyed it thoroughly.
That was the last episode.
Son of a...